sing Jesus Never Fails today. I know we don't have our normal ones to sing it. Hopefully we can get page number 20 in the book. None of them are turned on, by the way. We start that one in D flat normally, and then the last verse we step up to E flat. I don't know if we're going to keep it in the same gear today or not.
So many souls have tested him throughout the course of time. So many still reach out to him with broken hearts and minds. And every one of them will say, without exception, that they find that Jesus never fails. Even in the days of old, he brought his people through. And then he came to show his love, and he died for me and you. And then he rose again to prove that every story had been true, that Jesus never failed.
This world brings trouble that I find so hard to bear. I know I could not make it without Jesus being there. It's so encouraging to know, however deep we're in despair, that Jesus never fails. So what can I do? Tell me, how can you deny? No untold facts, no mysteries. It's all so cut and dry. And on the witness stand of your life, I'll be the first to testify that Jesus never fails.
Jesus never fails.
Thank you.
Too many treasures are waiting.
there's been kind of a going theme over the last year in our family of giving thanks in all things. And then yesterday I went to a women's conference up in Oneida, and one of the speakers spoke on beauty in the struggle. And we may not see the big picture that God's got for us. In the chorus where it says the treasure's untold, there's things about heaven that John couldn't write about.
That's right.
He couldn't speak on it because God didn't want him to. He told him to shut that part of the book up. And that's for us to find out when we get there, when we get with him. But finding beauty in your struggle and giving thanks in all things is an extremely hard place to be. Because when you're in the middle of that struggle, you think that there's no end in sight. There's no access to happiness. There's no access to joy. There's no access to having what you thought was supposed to be perfect in your life. But God's word doesn't say to be happy in all things. He doesn't say to have joy in all things. He does say to rejoice evermore. But he says to give thanks in all things. And to be thankful for all things, the most things that we need to be thankful for, on top of everything else, if he never offered me anything else in this life, but to be thankful for my salvation. When Brother Dean preached a few weeks ago about talking about people that struggle and they say, I'm struggling with my salvation. I know people have said that, but in that same moment in time, there was one time Tony and I had a conversation of Satan questions, God commands. And my heart goes back to that all the time. So when you're questioning your salvation, that has nothing to do with God, because God is not the author of confusion. So the struggles and the heartache in our lives is not sent to us for confusion. Satan's out there sifting us as wheat. And if you've ever known anything about the wheat and the threshing floor, and how they throw that wheat in the air and the tares come and the wind takes away what is supposed to take it away, and we feel like we're just being blown from here and there. And it's been a tough year for a lot of people. It's been a tough year. But even in all of that toughness, to have to stop and say, thank you, Lord. He didn't have to give us access into his family. He didn't have to give us access to the throne room. Remember what they used to have to do before he even said it is finished? They used to have to send special people in to speak for you. And now, no matter where you are, I can pray standing up tall. I can pray on my knees. I can pray silently. I can pray out loud. I can pray reaching other people.
Right.
So today, I'm going to give thanks in everything. I'm going to give thanks in the struggle. I'm going to give thanks in the beauty of the struggle.
Yeah.
I'm going to give thanks for what he's done for me in my heart, in my life. I'm going to give thanks that my 18-year-old daughter is watching live and says, Mom, I have him sing thank you, Lord, and that seems to have been what needed to be done. And I'm thankful that even though she is off in another state, that her heart is still attached here to know, ask for thank you, dear Lord. So while he sings this second verse, there's trials, there's snares, there's a whole lot of junk we're going to go through in this life. Let us reflect today on what we have and not what we don't have. Because even Job had everything taken away from him, and he'd give it to him 10 times over. What God allowed Satan to take away, God replaced that and then some. So today, let's give thanks in the struggle. Let's give thanks for nothing else. If you can't stop and praise God for anything else in this world but your salvation, reflect on that, because this is the worst it gets for us as children of God. We're never going to have to see or hear anything to do with hell. We don't have to worry about that. So our worst struggle here, that's still way better than a hot burning hell. And I'm so thankful I don't have to go.
Life is full of snares. Trials seem so hard to bear. That's when I reach for that hand. I know it's always there. And finding he still cares, I bow my head and say this little prayer.
I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or land. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hand than to be a king of a vast domain or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide fame. I'd rather have Jesus. I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide fame. I'd rather be faithful to his dear cause. I'd rather have Jesus than and worldwide fame. I'd rather be true to His holy name than to be a king of a vast domain or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today.
These words are way different than what I'm used to singing with, but beyond all that, I'd rather have Jesus than anything. And that holds true.
Some songs that has touched me in such a way that I can't get them out of my circulation, I guess is the best way to put it. But this is one of those songs that I have to be reminded sometimes there ain't no reason to doubt Him. He's done more than enough to cause me not to doubt. My own flesh and my own problems and my own struggles causes me to doubt, but He's never done one thing to cause me to doubt. Just pray for me. It's been a little bit since I played this one, so it may not be perfect, but I'm just thankful to be able to do something for the Lord. Looking back through the years, the heartaches and tears, my Lord has never once let me down. Trust in His plan, for He said that His grace would abound, and there's no need to doubt Him now. He'll make a
tell these kids that. Try to encourage them that if they mess up, just back up and do it again. So I've got the right words now. So if y'all don't want to hear me sing this, you just gonna have to hear me anyway. Amen. But I love the Lord this morning. I appreciate each and every one of you being here, and I'll give you some scripture here in just a little while. But He's been good to me. Far better than I have been to Him at many times. And, I'm grateful for Him today.
Well, I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. Well, I'd rather be His than have riches untold. Well, I'd rather have Jesus than houses or lands. Well, I'd rather be led by His nail-pierced hand than to be a king of a vast domain or be held in sin's dread sway. Well, I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. Well, I'd rather have Jesus than men's applause. Well, I'd rather be faithful to His dear cause. Well, I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide fame. Well, I'd rather be true to His home. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. I like this last verse. He's fairer than lilies of rarest bloom. Sweeter than honey from out of the comb. He's all that my hungry spirit needs. I'd rather have Jesus and let Him lead. And to be a king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than this world affords today.
Well, he is fairer than lilies. It does something for me. He's sweeter than honey from out of the comb. He's all that hungry spirit needs. Well, I'd rather have Jesus and let him lead. Help me sing it. Than to be a king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's great sway. I'd rather have Jesus sing it with me, really. That will you, that last, that third verse. He's fairer than lilies of rarest bloom. He's sweeter than honey from out of the comb. He's all that my hungering spirit needs. Oh yeah, I'd rather have Jesus and let him lead. Than to be a king of a vast domain, or be anything this world affords today. Lord, I got just a little bit of scripture that I want to read to you here, and boy, it's just been a good spirit here all morning long, and thankful and grateful for that. And good liberty. There's always good liberty. Where there's good liberty, that's where he's at. Look with me in the book of Psalms with me for just a second. Got a couple of things that I want to look at here in the book of Psalms, Psalms 51. Psalms 51. I want to look at about three or four verses there. I won't hold you. I know that we've been here a good while. Praise the Lord for it. I love coming to church on Sunday, seeing his people, being with his people, being with our family. See, that's what it means to be a child of God. You become part of something that's much bigger than just ourselves. It's much bigger than just Calvary Baptist Church. It's much bigger than the sanctuary. It's much bigger than the fellowship hall. It's much bigger than the dinners, even though they're great. It's much bigger than that. But we become, when you accept the Lord Jesus Christ, you become part of something. And it's far greater than anything in this world. Amen? But it's so easy, so oft times, to just lose focus and to lose track as our purpose. And I tell you what, if you get the opportunity and the Lord leads, just talk to some Christian people, maybe outside of church, but talk to some Christian people
that claim to be a Christian, and I'm not saying doubting or nothing all like that, but just talk to them just for a second. And it don't take very long to see that so many people has lost their vision. So many people, I'm talking about, and I'm not being mean when I say that, and I'm not being mean towards people in general, but I say, Calvary Baptist Church, that it's real easy to lose your side of this thing. Amen. I think about the book of Psalms here, Psalms 51 in particular. Those that want to stand, be welcome to do so. I'm just going to read a couple of verses here for you. It says here in verse number 11, it said, "Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not the Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of my salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit. Then will I teach transgressors thy ways, and sinners shall be converted unto thee." Let us have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for yet another privilege, another opportunity, God, to be in your house. Lord, we pray your leadership. We pray your guidance, Father. We pray that you would be at the center of each and everything said and done. Father, we thank you for the good words, Lord God, that we've heard today. Father, we thank you for the good song. And Lord, we pray that, Lord God, that you would be high and lifted up, Lord God, during this time. And Lord, that we could be a blessing unto you. Father, we pray that you would hide us behind your cross. Lord, guard our tongues. Help us not ever say or do anything of this flesh. But Lord God, let us be of the Spirit this morning. For it's in your precious name we do pray. And the church said, amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. So it says there, it says, cast me not away from thy presence. Yeah. Where do you want to be? Right. Where do you want to be? You want to be close to him? Do you want to be, I would say that if I was taking a poll this morning to everyone here that say yes, I want to be close to the Lord, and I want him to be close to me. I want him to lead me and guide me and direct me. I want him to direct my footsteps. I want him to direct everything within my life. But what happens so many times is we lose focus of that. What happens is so many times that many of us have to go to work. Now, I'm a firm believer in working hard. If you're here and you think you're just going to get a free ride through this thing, me and you can't be friends. Amen. I believe that a man ought to pull his weight. I believe a man ought to do his part. Amen. Especially if you're a husband, and if you're a daddy, you say, "Now, preacher, you're getting into opinion." No, that's scripture. The Bible says you don't work, you don't eat. Amen. There's too many out there with their hands out today. Amen. That's why I have to work till I'm 80, because there's so many people dependent upon it. I'm not being mean when I say that right there. I believe we ought to pull our weight, and believe we ought to do our part. But sometimes in the workforce and sometimes in the workplace, sometimes it's real easy to lose track of this thing and lose sight of just exactly what we're about. Amen? And so it's real easy that we allow things, that we allow separation to come between us and God. Right. And you say, "Well, Brother Tim, that's why it's important that we strive every day. That's why it's so important that reading our Bible every morning, getting our mind right," as the preacher said, and Brother Dean's made mention of it. That makes two times that it's been said today. With me making mention of it, it'll be three times in the last month that it talks about that the preacher's standing and talking about getting your mind right. Now, it's not talking about your mind right about your job or your work or whatever it is that you need to do. Hey, man, those are things that some of these days are not even going to matter. But friend, you're in charge of some things that does matter. And you say, "What is that?" And that is the work of the Lord. Amen. And that is the work of the church. That is the work of the Holy Spirit, Lord God, that the Lord God would work through us and to reach and to touch people. Amen. And so the psalmist David wrote there, and he said, "Cast me not away from thy presence." Amen. Why? Because I need the presence of God.
Amen.
Maybe some of you here today that you may be a lot stronger than I and all that. And you know what? I say praise the Lord for you, but I need you. I need you, and I need the presence of God through you. And you'll need the presence of God through me. Amen? That's why it's so important, our daily walk with the Lord Jesus Christ, that we have that relationship with Him. The psalmist was writing there. He said, cast me not away. I don't want to be cast away from the Lord. I don't want to be distant from the Lord. I don't want to be separated from God. I don't want to be separated from the Lord. You say, Brother Tim, the Bible says that there's nothing on the face of this earth that can ever separate us from the love of God. Absolutely, I agree with that. But we can separate. We can allow separation become between us and God. And once we do that, and it's so very important that once we do that, we begin to lose track of things. Now, with that mindset, with that thought, I know we've been here for a little bit. Just hang with me for just a second, if you could. In the book of Matthew, in the 6th chapter, it says this: lay not up for yourselves treasures upon the earth, where moth and dust, or moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures where? In heaven. Amen. You gonna be able to take your bass boat to heaven? Nope. You gonna be able to take your side by side to heaven? Nope. I'm gonna get real personal. You gonna be able to take your bow to heaven, will you? You gonna be able to take your tree stand to heaven, will you? Nope. Hey man, you're gonna be, there ain't gonna be no malls in heaven. Somebody say amen to that. Amen. I believe that with all my heart. Amen? Listen here. You're going to be able to take your money to heaven? Boy, that was pitiful right there. Amen? Your money ain't going to matter in heaven. You're going to be able to take your pretty manicure yard to heaven? You're going to be able to take your house and land and all of that? You're going to be able to take any of that to heaven with you? So what is it that you're going to take to heaven? What is it that we, hang with me now, what is it that we are going to take to heaven with us? Our soul and what else? Our what? Our works, some of our works, amen. Listen, some of our works, but we're not going to get there because of works, but our works for the Lord Jesus Christ, amen. We're going to get to heaven, and you know what we're going to take with us? Nothing from this world and nothing from this earth other than our testimony, other than what we did for the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And that's all that's going to matter. So does it matter? What matters this morning? What matters? What kind of vehicle you drive, does that really matter? No. Does it matter? Does it matter if you, how big your house is? Does that really matter? But you see where I'm coming. Does what you got, does your bank account really matter? We all need money. Sure. Right. Ian's clown plumb up on me right there. Amen. If you'll help me, I'll get done with this. We all got to have money to make it. Amen. We do. But are you going to take that to heaven with you? How is it that we lose focus so quickly? You say, Brother Tim, you wasn't here Wednesday night because you was working. I agree with that. I'm bivocational. I have to work. Amen. But I know that I'm not going to be able to take my money to heaven with me. I know that. But what can I take to heaven? This. What can I take to heaven with me? Where's some of these babies at? That's what matters. These babies that we bring in on Wednesday night, can we take them? Can we get them there? Listen, that's the only hope that they have is right here what's taking place. Many of them, and I'm not being mean when I say this, I love their mamas and their daddies and their grandparents and all that, but many of them, Many of them, the only Jesus that they're ever going to see is what Calvary Baptist Church and some of our sister churches within our community does as an outreach type program. That's the only hope of Jesus Christ that they're ever going to see. And that's right here. Amen. So is it important that we stay close to the Lord? Or is it important, just like the psalmist said right there, that Lord, that you don't separate from me? But verse number 10, he said this. Verse number 10, Psalms 51 right there. Verse number 10 said, create in me a what? Whoa, that's where a lot of people has a lot of trouble right there. There's some separation begins, but hey, listen here. That separation begins when you go to praying, Lord, create in me a clean heart. Why? Because I don't want to be separated from you. That's what that next verse, that's what it's leading up to. Verse number 10 said, create in me a clean heart. Listen here. When you go to when you go before the Lord and you say, Lord, hang with me and I'll try to be done. Lord, create in me a clean heart that I'll not be separated from you. There's some separation begins to take place in within your very own heart. And you say, Brother Tim, how's that encouraging for us this morning? Well, you've got a decision to make. Do you want to work and lay up things here with thieves and a match or a flame may burn our house down today? I hope not. And I hope I'm not jinxing anybody by no means. Amen. Or do we want to work for spiritual things that matter? You said you made mention, Brother Tim, that it's easy to lose focus. Is it? Sure. It's easy that workplace scheduling and all that, anybody that's ever been in any kind of management type position or whatever within your workplace, hey, it's easy to get wrapped up in that. And it's easy to carry it home with you. Amen? It is. It's easy to become worrisome over things that don't even matter. Oh my goodness, what are we going to do with this? What are we going to do that? Is it worth worrying over? You said, Brother Tim, do you not worry? Absolutely. I got two girls that's so-called grown, and then I got one little 8-year-old. Yeah, that's why I'm gray. Somebody say amen to that. Whoa. And they're girls, amen. Lord's got a sense of humor, amen. I worry about them at times. Pray for them often. What about your girls? What about your girls? Do I worry about them? Absolutely, I worry about your children. Pray for them often. That's what matters. What we have here, what matters and what doesn't matter. It'd be real good for us today to distinguish and decide within our heart what matters and what don't matter. What matters? What matters fleshly and what matters spiritually? Listen, verse number 20, Matthew chapter number 6, I'm trying to hurry. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven. I made mention of this. I said this. I made mention of my great-granny that we were standing there in the cemetery, and I'll not forget it. It was in about the middle of December, and we were standing in that cemetery up there at Elizabeth and about middle ways up that hill and all. And she never knew anywhere else other than Gobi, Emory River, Tennessee. She never knew of any third world country. She didn't know of any. She went to the ocean a time or two and said, I asked her, I said, what'd you think about that? She said, well, it was all right, I guess. I had to get back home. My beans was coming in. Down there standing at the edge of the ocean worried about her beans coming in. That sounded like Brandon. I heard that, Kim. Amen. But I said this, she never knew anything other than this right here. sitting under an evangelist, and I come to a close. His grandma and his papa raised him. And he said this. He said that they lived in a shack with nothing but dirt floors. Every morning. Some of you women that think you got to have a big house and all the fine things in this life, listen here. Every morning that little woman got up. Every single morning she fixed breakfast. That's the thing unheard of. Somebody say amen to that. Amen. I got to be careful. You know what she done? She got up every single morning. She fixed breakfast. And guess what else she did? She swept those dirt floors. And she prayed every single day. Little fella said and made mention, he said he would leave out and sometimes she'd be praying. And he said he'd come back in around lunchtime and she'd be praying. He said, for a long period in my life, I thought that she, my granny, never done nothing other than pray. And he said, I got up of age and I began to make my own decisions and I began to go out on my own and I began to fool or dilly-dabble around in sin. And he said, before long, I became an alcoholic. And before long, I was mean. I was one of them mean drunks, he said. And he said, as he came into that little lady's house, he said he even drawed back to slap his little granny one time. He said his papa come in and told him, said, son, you got to go. You're going to be in our house. It ain't much, but you're not staying here. And he said he left and the Lord began to work on him. And remember I said she prayed and prayed and prayed. Yeah. Ended up, make a long story short, just about parallel with the prodigal son. He came back. Accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as his Savior, came back. Just a great story ending. But he said this, he said she never seen the product of her prayers. Never seen the product, she seen the value in it, but she never seen her prayers other than him accepting Christ. Never seen her prayers and the product of her prayers. All she ever knew was that dirt floor. He got to testifying about how that he couldn't imagine the first time that she went into heaven or the first time that she opened her eyes in the presence of the Lord. And all she ever knew was a shack and dirty and just dirt floors that she swept every day. But he said she'd never seen the product of her prayers. Let me ask you something. Did her prayer life matter? Does your prayer life matter? Is it effective? Does it make a difference? Absolutely. And as he began to preach, and as he preached, and as he wrapped up, as a young man, I sat there and I wept. He said she never earthly got to see the return of her prayers earthly. But he said, the Lord called me to preach. And he said, I go all over the world preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. And he said, there's souls upon souls upon souls upon souls that come to know the Lord Jesus Christ every single year. He wasn't boasting when he was saying it, but he said, there's people that come to know the Lord every single year because of the ministry that God placed upon his life. But he stood and he wept. He said, But all that goes back to the prayers of my little grandmama.
Yep.
So what matters to us? What matters to you? What's our focus on? Brother Jake testified, I didn't. Brother Jake testified Wednesday night and got about 2 van loads coming. What a blessing. Think that's by accident? You say, Brother Tim, they drive me nuts when they go, they do me too sometimes. You drive me nuts sometimes, amen? Not the kids, you adults, amen. I'm being transparent, maybe a little. But the only hope that they have is you presenting to them the gospel of Jesus Christ. So can I say to you teachers on Wednesday nights, when you're back there and you're tired from your work and you're tired for all that, and now you're back there with 30 screaming kids back there, it's about to eat the sheetrock off the walls. I get it. But that's what matters. That's what matters, Calvary. Is it easy to lose focus? It is. But what matters? Let's all stand to our feet and go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for your grace and your mercy and all you do for us, Father. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the thought this morning, God, and we thank you again for all you do for us. Lord, for saving us. Lord, for keeping us, Father. And Lord God, we pray that we, every single one, could strive, Lord God, for that closeness, Lord God, to you. The book of James said to draw nigh to God.